Just to know. you holy. Your name is holy. You are so holy. I call you holy. Your name is holy. Holy you are.
Yeah! Amen. Sweet hour of prayer.
For people who are going through stress, sorrow, and pain, we will quote and give them a word from the Lord. But I think all of us have found out at times in all of our lives, we know that God is faithful to his word. But then the enemy tries to creep into your mind, and he tries to destroy or tear down the thinking that you had before you were going through the storm. Now, going through a storm and saying that men that I should always pray and not give up is altogether different than when I'm in the sunshine and I can say that to someone. But can I still say it like the storm, the weather persons, meteorologists are telling us that later on this evening that there is going to be a lot of thunder, a lot of rain, which is emblematic of the fact that life is like this. All life, every life, will have some thunder, some lightning, and some rain. And the question is, can my faith be so rooted in the faithfulness of God that I can still say that men ought always to pray and not to faint? There have been several requests for prayer. And at this moment, before the word of God is expounded, I'm going to ask that those who would desire prayer, that we're going to have altar prayer now, that you would come and stand and clasp the hand of the person that's standing next to you, in fact, on both sides, on your left and to the right. For if ever there was a moment in our city, in our nation, in our lives, if we ever needed prayer, we need prayer now. We need it desperately. Men, people, all of God's anointed ones ought to always pray and not to give up. You can't give up. Even when I don't see God moving, when I don't see him doing anything, by faith I trust him and his word. For he says in Hebrews 13, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. In our city, as you know, there is anticipation of a decision rendered that some are thinking that this is going to cause violence in our city and is going to erupt in terms of anger, property being destroyed, maybe some lives being attacked. We don't know what's going to happen. But we do know the God that we serve. And we know he's able. We don't know how it's going to work out, but we have to put it in his hands. Even the evil is under his control. You remember in Job chapter 1 and chapter 2, before Satan could do anything to Job, he had to get God's permission. And God is still on his throne. He still has all power. He's in control. He is the chief of life. And now as we gather our thoughts and our hearts and our spirits, and as we lift them as a fragrant flavor before the throne of God, let us pray together. Oh God, our help in ages past, our hope, my hope, for years to come. Our shelter, my shelter from a stormy blast, and our, my eternal home. Before the hills and altar stood, and earth had not received her dress and her beauty, from everlasting thou art God, to endless years the same. We come, Master, that you've allowed us by your mercy, because we know that mercy keeps from us what we deserve. And dear God, I can hear Paul say, where there's evil and darkness, the more it increases, the more that grace abounds. We know by experience, by what you have done in our lives personally, by what we have seen you do in the lives of others, that you are able to part a Red Sea. You are able, dear God, to deliver out of any circumstance. You are able to give peace, and you're able to give comfort and calmness to a disrupted spirit, to a disquieted mind. You're able, dear God, to bring harmony in the midst of chaos. First of all, we lift our city here in St. Louis. We know that the enemy is looking for ways to bring disruption, to bring destruction, to hurt lives and property. But we're calling on you, and we're asking you, dear God, for your intervention. We don't know what needs to be done, but we do know one thing. We do know that you have the power over all of this, over the madness, over the evil, over persons who have been paid to cause trouble, over the bad laws, over the injustice. You have power. And we're asking you to step in, dear God, and to work it out according to your divine plan. Don't let any lives be lost. Don't let any property be destroyed. Let there be peace, dear God. And where there's injustice, bring justice, Lord. We want you to ride in St. Louis. We want you to show the dark forces here in St. Louis that Satan is not the last word, but my God, who sits on high, who rides on the cloud, and who steps on his seas, and who quietens the storms, my God, can speak, and everything will be all right. Not only do we lift our city here, but dear God, we lift our church here, Pleasant Green, and all churches for that matter. But dear Heavenly Father, we need you in our church family. We need your strength. We need your wisdom. We need your guidance. We need your instruction. You told us if we call on you, in the third chapter of Proverbs, you said that we didn't know, we don't have future knowledge, but you said if we ask you, you will give it to us. So we're asking like children, not begging, because, dear God, we are of royal blood. Your son, Jesus Christ, died on Calvary for us. We have been bought, sought, and delivered. And we say, thank you, Lord. We don't want it for selfish reasons, but we want your glory, your honor, to be displayed in our midst. Lord, we ask that lives will be healed, minds will be mended, circumstances will be brought under your control. whether it's in the home, whether it's children, grandchildren, on the job, it don't matter. You are here before any of this gets started. You'll be here when all of this is over with. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah of Nazareth, have your way. Move. Holy Spirit, breathe on us. Blow on us. Clean out of us our arrogance, our pride, our selfishness. Teach us humility. Teach us the softness of love. We thank you right now. We don't see it, but it ain't important. You said it, it will be done. And so we live on that. We act on that. We move forth on that. Oh, Lord, you're a good God. And you're worthy for us to be here this morning. And we ask you to forgive us. Our sins are many. And if we pretend as though that we have no sin, you contradict that, because you told us in your word, all have sinned. Not a few, not some, not the scum of the earth, but everybody has sinned and come short of the mark of your holy perfection. Keep working in our hearts. Keep our eyes on the prize, because we know that our days here, our journey here on this earth is getting shorter. And there are more days behind us than there are days in front of us. So teach us to number our days, to realize the preciousness of life. For every moment is a moment that you don't have to give us, but you do it because you love us. Thank you for your grace that has saved us. Now, Lord, as the word, your word goes forth, open our hearts, open our minds, remove all of the distractions, any trash that we brought in with us, clean it out of us. Prepare us to be filled with your word, so that we can leave here changed people. People that are filled again and empowered to share your word, to live out your word, so that somebody will see Jesus Christ in us. Thank you again for what you have done, what right now you are doing, and what you promise you're going to do. We ask these petitions, these requests, again for your honor and glory, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, we pray. May we all say together, amen and amen.
Have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Yes, Lord. Privilege. with my brothers in the gospel. God bless you. To each one of you in your respectful place, I want to go back in prayer before I begin. Let us bow our heads. Eternal God, we thank you now for your word. We thank you for the privilege of speaking. We seek your guidance and your wisdom and your knowledge today as we examine your word. Bless our hearts to receive, our ears to hear, and bless us with a will to obey, that it may go well with us. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. To be honest with you, I really feel like listening. I believe God is talking. And it's difficult to hear him when you talk. But since I have to share a word with you, we will do as requested and we'll move out of the way. But I want to call your attention to Romans chapter 9. Beginning at verse 30 to verse 33. Romans chapter 9. Verses 30 through 33. You have to say amen. Amen. Paul says here, what shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith. But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Verse 32, why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were, by the works of the law. For they stumbled at the stumbling stone. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. God bless you. You may take your seat. I just want to use for a thought today, making decisions. We all have, I'm not a Jew, but I have, and you probably have not recognized that you have Israel-like tendencies. We all have tried to do things our way. Some are still saying they're going on to heaven anyhow. But this passage, penned in AD 57, toward the end of Paul's third missionary tour, it is also parenthetical. We need to read all of chapter 9 through chapter 11, that we can get an understanding in the unfolding of the gospel. But what about the Jew? They made a mistake. What I love about, as I look even into my own life, I've made a lot of mistakes. But God has been so kind enough to cover that mistake. We can say a lot about Israel, but they are God's elect, period. There's absolutely nothing that can be done about that. And we have to table messages of reprobation because God is not finished. There is a dilemma here. They are in a position that God does not want them to be in. And God has to fix it. When I was reading this, I thought about these chairs that are seated behind me. And all of these preachers are sitting in one of them. These chairs represent a position. Am I making sense? I didn't at first choose to sit in one of these chairs. The chairs that I picked out were in taverns, and bars, and dope houses, those kinds of places. But God had selected, and when I say this is a position, He desired that I preach the gospel. And I'm still, as the young folks say, I'm still tripping off of the fact that how He got me out of a tavern into a house. Israel, they are not where the Lord wants them to be by faith. But if you go over into the 11th chapter of Romans, God says they're going to be saved. How is He going to get them from doing things on their own to the way He has set it up for them? This is also a mystery. And many are saying many things, and they may be stumbling, Israel. You may be stumbling. But if God has purposed something for your life, to elect means to select or choose. According to the Bible, before creation, God selected from the human race those whom He would redeem, justify, sanctify, and glorify in Jesus Christ. He's already figured it out. Sometimes, and it's good that we come to church, but just because you come to church does not mean that you're in the body of Christ. Am I making sense? You cannot get into the body of Christ except you come by faith. That's why God keeps sending messages. I don't believe God would have sent me from or brought me from where He brought me from to here to work in this ministry if there was no one that needed to be saved. What shall we say then? Having accounted for Jewish unbelief in terms of sovereignty, Paul now diagnoses it as due to a fatal prior commitment to a false way of righteousness. Divine sovereignty and the guilt of human willfulness are, for Paul, two aspects of reality. By God's grace and sovereignty, Gentiles who did not seek God's righteousness have now received it through faith. Sometimes we're doing things that God did not command us to do. And you should understand it won't work for you. But faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ works every time. Israel as a people have failed to receive it because they sought it by legal means in which it could not be found. You know, laws to me, and I know that Paul here, the Mosaic law is in view here, but we have many laws that guide us. Governing principles, mindsets, thinking it should be this way and that way. Now, that's what Israel was doing. They thought they could attain a righteousness with God by works of the law. You cannot justify yourself. Works have always been a threat to grace. Always will be. When the Lord says you must be born again, it's foolish to think you don't have to be born again to have fellowship with God. It's foolishness. Christ has been to the Jews a stumbling stone, of which they have fallen. So many in the church have fallen. We are falling because of our lack of faith. Falling because of too many doctrines. I'm not asking.
Oh, yeah, let me say that.
The mistake that the Jews made lies not in what they pursued, but the manner of their pursuing. It was nothing wrong with them going after the law, but the Bible helps us understand that Christ is the end of the law. So their studying of the law should have led them to Jesus Christ. It should have demonstrated to them that they had never been able to keep the law. They were always stumbling, inconsistent, disobedient. So there, they stumble, not by faith, but by works of the law. Let me say this to you, church. Stay away from these doctrines. Let me put it to you. We were talking about this in evangelism on Monday night. The Bible helps us understand, if you come another way, other than the way of Jesus Christ, you will be dealt with as a thief and a robber. Do you understand that? But this dilemma, God the potter selected the cross as the mold for his redemptive purposes. The Gentiles or other races or other folk outside of Israel, the Gentiles in faith accepted that mold and obtained a righteousness that is by faith. You wonder why some folk are saved and you're not. You wonder why some folk are delivered and you're not. You wonder why some folk have a spirit of praise and some folk do not. But Paul goes on to say here in the 10th chapter of Romans, I got two scriptures and I'll be through. The 10th chapter, verse 1, he said, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they be saved." You know, that's my concern as a minister. I'm wondering who needs to be saved. Paul goes on to say in verse 2, "For I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge." They don't have the accurate, we were talking about that in Sunday school lesson this morning about interpretation. It's all right to have knowledge of the Bible, but you need to know how to interpret the Bible. Anybody can quote it, but how does it apply to me? Everybody knows Jesus gave his life and shed his blood, but what kind of death did he die? You need to know he died a death to sin. Huh? And we gonna have to die that death. Huh? There's some that say you don't have to die that death. You can have your cake and you can eat it too. But that's not scripture. God says this about himself. He said, "Be ye holy. I am holy, saith the Lord." Paul goes on to say here about Israel, "For they being ignorant." That's why we have Bible class at Sunday school. I said to him this morning, we all here to learn something. Nobody has graduated to my knowledge. But I need to clear up the ignorance. Some of you have questions, and you should. It's your soul. That either is going to be saved or lost. You need to ask those questions. There's somebody here that can help you understand. Am I making sense? Here's where we have that Jew in us and seeking to establish their own righteousness. Don't we do that? Oh, I put X amount of money in the church. I heard that since I've been here. They say, "I've been a member of Pleasant Green for 40, 50, 60 years. Can I tell you something? God is not impressed." That's good that you kept an attendance card for 40 years. Are you a member of the body of Christ? Not Pleasant Green. Have you accepted the message that God gave concerning his son? For God so loved the world that he gave. Did you accept the gift? And more to the point, are you born again? The old saints would question us as children. But they didn't use born again. They wanted to know, had you been converted? Means the same thing. Paul goes on to say here, they have not submitted. Can we talk about that? Huh? Relegated themselves. Come down off your high horse, who you think you are. If you are unsaved, you need to be saved. Whatever your status is, however much money you have in the bank, God doesn't, is not impressed by those things. I thought I could make it off of the coattail of my mom and dad. I rode that for a long time. As long as they were saved, I was good. But I thought, and sometimes we are thinking that we can establish ourselves before God of some kind of work. It won't help you. Verse 4 says, for Christ is the end of the law. For righteousness, what does that mean? To be in right standing with God. To be justified. Those sins of your past, present, and future have been atoned for in the precious blood. And until we arrive, God keeps sending messages to us. What I love about Romans chapter 11, God knew these folk, his folk was in trouble. But the Bible said they received a partial hardening. God just put them on hold. But the Bible said until the full number of the Gentiles have been brought in to the Bible. So he has not abandon Israel. God has not abandoned you. If he woke you up this morning and signed you on your way, like every truth about God, the doctrine of election involves mystery. And it sometimes stirs controversy. You have to stop listening to folks saying you ain't gonna never make it. Folk will condemn you to hell, but God keeps on waking the sinner saying to be living longer than anybody. God loves the sinner. Jesus said that he came to seek and to save. If you're sitting here today and sin, you know what? God is looking directly at you. And in a minute, I'm going to say, will you come? And you're going to have to make it to see. Huh? Be careful telling God to wait a minute. You know, I ain't ready. The wages. Why you waiting? But in Scripture, it is a pastoral doctrine helping Christians to see how great is the grace that saves them. This is a great thing that we have. And moving them to respond with humility, confidence, and praise. We do not know what others God has chosen among those who do not yet believe, nor why he chose us in particular. We do know that we believe how only because we were chosen, and we know that as believers, we can rely on God to finish the good work he has begun. That's why I praise the Lord, because I know I'm in a process. Huh? Israel is going through a process. Huh? You may not like it, but God says, I'm going to still save them. Can I tell you why he's going to save them? Because he's sovereign. Whatever he has said, he is able to bring it to pass. Be careful with things you listen to. I told them this morning, and I know we are waiting a decision in Ferguson, and there's still a lot of killing in the land. But I told them, if you cannot process the news, turn the television off. The media, that's what they do. They report bad stuff. And I said to the Sunday school class this morning, do not let the spirit of fear into your spirit, no matter what happens. Let me share something with you in Philippians chapter 3. I'm almost finished. Philippians chapter 3, verse 8. You have to say amen. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. You know what I hate about the church, Pastor Louis, love? We don't have the power. That we should have. Huh? We don't possess the authority that we should as Christians. If you are born again, filled with the Holy Ghost, you have some authority and you have some power. And if we hadn't, the church wouldn't be off course the way it is.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to show you that in a minute.
Oh, yeah.
But the Bible says this about our Lord and Savior, that on the third day he got up. That's what Paul is saying here. And the fellowship of his suffering. We know about going through.
Yeah.
We know about trials. Huh? Doesn't bother me.
I've been in pain for the other 2 years.
Sometimes when you're hurting, Reverend, for so long, it don't bother you no more.
Yeah.
It's just the same old, same old.
Yeah.
But it has never stopped me from doing what God has called me to do. If I get so to where I can't walk, somebody like that, give him a chair and a microphone.
Uh-huh.
Nothing wrong with his mouth.
The Lord, all right.
He got a preach.
Yes, Lord.
Being conformed to his death. Huh? We face death all day long. Huh? The devil been trying to kill us. Huh? If by means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead.
You know, I look ahead. I try to leave this world heavy. You know, if I had time to take my coat off and I leave it over there on the chair, that's what I do with the world. I carry it as a loose garment. Huh? If you've been saved, you should have done everything under the sun by now as a sinner. Am I making sense? There's nothing we haven't done from A to Z. So those kinds of things, what I'm trying to say to you is that I'm looking for the return of my Savior. He said he was coming back again. I want to be ready. Wait a minute. I want to be faith ready. Am I making sense? Huh? And we can be that if we do what Paul told Timothy. We got to do some fighting. Don't let the devil just take away from the house of the Lord. This is where we receive instruction. This is where I want. This is school for me. Somebody said something to me about my bag. They said, I don't want that bag. I'm in school. You ought to have a bag. You ought to take some notes. Flip some pages. I like to hear that flip when I'm preaching. Pages turn. That means you got a Bible. Let me finish with you in the first epistle of John, chapter 5. The first epistle of John, chapter 5, verse 4 and verse 5. And I'm going to go back to the position that God put me in. Listen to this, church. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. Let me say that to you another way. The world shouldn't be running your life. You shouldn't be tossed to and fro. The devil does not have any business mastering a saint of God. Don't let these folks fool you. John says here, this is the victor that has overcome the world. It's your faith. That's why you can't overcome. That's why you can't stop. Huh? Somebody told me once, they said, Reverend, I can't help it. How much faith do you have? Huh? What do you mean you can't help it? What do you mean you can't stop doing evil? What do you mean by that? John says here, your faith should have overcome. Am I making sense? And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Watch this. Who is he who overcomes the world? But he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Those are the overcomers. Those are the ones that have the power. You know, I've been dealing with this spirit for a long time because, as I said, one of the things the Lord delivered me from was alcohol over 20, 25 years, an alcoholic. But when the Lord came in, Pleasant Green, I don't know if you know this or not, but God is able. The problem with us overcoming for me are missed opportunities to become indoctrinated. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Think about that for a minute.
Yeah.
You can't draw from something you don't have. If you don't know the word of God, you cannot use it when temptations and trials come.
Yeah.
You cannot use it. If Jesus is not your Lord and Savior, how are you going to call on him? That's something to think about. We don't like the preacher. That's what that word on the street. But how can you hear?
Uh-huh.
Amen. Huh? You need a preacher somewhere. These positions that I talk to you about, we act as God's representatives unto salvation. And God has appointed each one of them as uniquely as he desired for them to fulfill a role. So, if you, I'm going to leave alone. If you discount one of them, you discount the brotherhood. I'm going to make this sense. We need to stop making a distinction.
Yeah.
Let God make the distinction.
Yeah.
I solicit all your prayers. I know some of you all have been praying for me, but pray for the brethren. We all are trying to work at the same thing here. I have to be careful. Reverend Armstrong won't mind this, but he talked to me a few weeks ago. But I'm going to tell you something. When we sat down to talk, the one thing that came out of his mouth, before he said anything to me, he said, I'm speaking to you in love. Heard what you said. And when I got ready to talk to him, I said, I love you, Reverend. Am I making sense?
Yeah.
We will agree on everything, but the love has to be fervent amongst the saints of God. Look at what God is doing with Israel. Here's some folks that have rejected him, and he said, oh, I got it. You know why he's doing that? Because of love. That unconditional love to stay in it. You know, you and I have made some bad decisions, even as children of God. But it just don't look like it because God. He didn't even let nobody know about it. So I'm just knocking at the Jews today. But I have been where they are. And will go there again if I don't pay attention to the word of God. I'm trying to do things on my own. You can't make it by yourself. Can we just get rid of that spirit? You cannot make it by yourself. You need a strong faith in Jesus Christ. Your position is going to have to hold you. They're talking about Ferguson. It's got to go beyond that. We've had 143 deaths. 43 deaths in St. Louis today. I haven't checked the news yet. But they died in bunches. All over the place. Your neighborhood ain't safe. Your neighborhood ain't safe. Your neighborhood ain't safe. The only safety we have is in Jesus. I'm going to make it safe. Word of the Lord is a strong tower. and the righteous run therein. And he said, I hope, trust, and pray that I have given you something to think about. You need to read. Read Romans chapter 9, 10, and 11. But God is purposeful about sending messages your way. You just need to pay attention. Don't mock at the, you know, at the word of God. God is calling you. I don't care where you are. You could have been a member over here for 30 years. If you're not saved, you should be running down the aisle. It's not about your status, it's about salvation. And God won't be satisfied until you're a member of the body of Christ. We ask you to come. The invitation to discipleship is extended.